We're going to call this meeting to order. We'll begin the evening with public comment. Is anybody who wishes to speak? Seeing none. We'll move on to updates from council. If there are any. All right, we'll call updates from council. We got no items on the consent agenda. So we'll go right into the introduction of potential board candidates to fill two vacancies on the Parks and Recreation Board. We're going to have you all introduce yourself. Greg, you have anything before?
Just a flyer here for the Halloween Carnival. So if you've got somewhere that you can share this information with the public, we appreciate that. We've got that coming up on the 29th.
There we go. Thank you, sir. Then we'll move on into introductions. So we have Ms. Sydney Hammond and Mr. Rich Haskey. Ms. Hammond, if you want to just come to the podium.
That's nothing wrong, but just introduce yourself.
Half hour speech.
Yeah. Just talk a little bit about yourself and.
Well, half hour speech on the Lincoln, the fairy tales. I'm Sydney Hammond. I work for BorgWarner. I'm an engineer designing turbochargers, but also a runner. I run in this park a couple times a week and run races in other parks around the local area frequently. I also play recreational sports in some of the parks, so I'm passionate about this particular park. What's going on in Fletcher? I live off Gannon Bridge Road. Moved here about a year ago from Portland, Oregon.
Great. Any questions from the council?
Thank you for showing interest.
Yeah. Is there anything that you feel like we're missing in comparison to the area that you came from?
Yes. As a runner, I tend to want to run on longer trails that are pedestrian-only trails. And in Portland, I could run for 10 miles and not have to touch a road right out of my front door, which is really nice. The trail system there is pretty extensive that you could connect trails and go a pretty far distance if you wanted to and be safe. And that is something I would love to see us have more of here closer. It seems like there are quite a few stretches of shorter trails, and especially ones that I run on, but you can't connect to them.
Yeah.
Unless you go all the way down like the Swan Rabbit, which is, I'd rather stay closer.
Well, I know there's one in Henderson County that,
yeah, I'm actually running on the next weekend.
Still cross roads on that, I think.
Yeah. I think that's also one of the next few ones.
What do you like the most about our parks?
They are so clean. I think they do a great job of maintaining them, and everybody's really respectful. And I think you see a wide variety of activities. You see people playing soccer in the fields, pushing strollers on the walkways, riding bicycles, flying these crazy kites. So I think it's nice that you see a lot of different activities going on, and that it's even with all of that variety going on, it's still a really nice, clean environment to be in. And as a female running alone, I always feel safe, which is also really important.
That's important. And thanks to Parks and Rec, always maintaining our parks.
Yeah, they do a good job. Yeah. They really do.
Any other questions? We thank you.
Appreciate it.
And Mr. Haskey, I'm pretty sure I pronounced your name right last time. I hope I did again this time.
You did great.
Yeah.
Passing grade once again. Hello everyone. My name is Rich Haskey. As you might remember, I was a candidate for the zoning board earlier this year. I'm very excited to have this opportunity as well. I feel like it's more of a fit for my skill set and my passions. Parks and Rec, I have two young kids, and I came up going to parks and participating in city recreation my whole life, and I just really value the importance of it. I think it's a great way to build a community, get people out, get them active, get the community together. That's why I really place a value on it. I'm just like Sydney. I'm active at Fletcher Park a lot. I like to run, play disc golf. I'm very excited about the new courts that are happening, because I like to play tennis, and I'm excited to play pickleball as well. I'm very excited.
What do you like most about our parks?
like Sydney said, I mean, they're just so clean. Where I came from in Florida, we didn't always have that. We had a ton of different parks. The maintenance was not at the level that it should have been. So it's great to know that I can take my family there at any time and just have a nice, clean experience at the parks. And also, you know, Fletcher, Biltmore Park is just absolutely huge. There's so much space. You know, you can have your own little private experience if you want anywhere, go in the creek or, you know, whatever you want to do. So.
Another thing for Parks and Rec for their maintenance work. Do you have any questions, comments, council?
What elements would you add to the park that you were suggesting to the Parks and Rec Committee?
I would like to see maybe more of a variety of organized leagues and maybe tournaments offered at the park. I think, at least the neighborhood that I'm in, there's a good amount of young families and, you know, kids coming up. And for adults as well, I think it would be a good thing to maybe offer some different sports and, you know, just foster that community engagement that way as well.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thank you for your interest.
Thank you.
How long have you lived here?
Oh, sorry. I've lived here since January of 2021.
Okay.
But I lived here first in, back in 2014, 2015. I was actually in South Asheville, but we still attended the park a bunch back then. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
There are two vacancies. Correct, Craig?
Yes.
There's two vacancies.
There's two. Sandy Kilgore's technically ends the end of October. Correct.
Okay.
So we'll go vote on these.
Yeah, we'll vote. Okay. Yeah, so we can on these. So you all know.
Is it okay to put them on consent?
Yeah. There's two vacancies. There you go.
Yeah.
So thank you all. Next week we'll have an update from Steve Watkins, ABC Board Chairman. Moving on, item number six, consideration of the proposal for the poll code to conduct a citizen survey. Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. At the last meeting, I presented a staff report to you looking at different methods of doing a citizen survey, and I think the consensus was to do a written questionnaire version of it. And I presented a firm, Poll Code, which has had extensive experience doing citizen surveys for communities in North Carolina and other states. And I emailed you a copy of the proposal, and then also you've got one in your packet. And I also included an example of one of the more recent clients that I thought was a good just example to see the kind of template of the survey. And then there's also some specialized questions in there. And that was from the city of Coronado, California. They've done a bunch of these in North Carolina, but it was just a recent example that I thought would be a good one for you to see, because it goes into the basic citizen survey questions, and then it also follows it up with, and they pay extra, which I would recommend that you do as well, within the proposal for individualized questions. So I wanted you just to have an example of that to look at. I know I've shared another one at the last staff report. And just to kind of go through the process again. So what Polco does is they do a random sampling of the households, and they will send a postcard out that invites you, explains the process, and then invites you to participate in the survey. You go online, you complete it online, and then they follow it up with a written hard copy of the survey, I guess basically for those who don't want to do that online, and also as a reminder to complete the survey. And then after that, they have what's called an open period, and I would highly suggest, and this is where we try and capture our other residents who want to participate in the survey, so basically try and push it out to all residents, businesses, property owners in Fletcher to participate in the survey. So at that point, we would do, I'd recommend one of the Blackboard or Connect or Blackboard calls, something with social media, Facebook, our website, and then there'll be a, you know, a separate link to complete the survey. The process is, it's about a four-month process from formally engaging Polco to the final results. On the front end, I'd be getting with you on basically a draft of the survey and what that would look like and what might be some specialized questions if you wanted to go that route. And at the end of the proposal, they've got a breakdown of the costs. So to get the basic template and the what they call the National Citizen Survey done and deployed, and this also includes, they have a digital platform. So once you complete the survey, you're basically in a group that can respond to future surveys that are, you know, part of your constituency. So, and then if you want to continue with the digital platform, then you can at a much lower cost for subsequent years. I think it's in the $8,000 a year to continue on an annual basis with the digital platform where you can do subsequent surveys. But the base cost was $17,000. If you want to do the half page of custom questions, that was at $2,800. One element of it, I wasn't sure if because we don't have a large Spanish-speaking population base here, but they do offer a Spanish translation of the survey, and then they'll publish it online in Spanish for Spanish-speaking respondents. If we want to incorporate that part, it's $1,350. And then the remote presentation of the results. So basically a presentation of the results of the entire survey at $2,400. So the total cost, including all those things, is $23,550. They're, you know, a highly reputable firm that has conducted these types of surveys with local governments for a number of years. They partner with the International City County Management Association, National League of Cities, and merged with a larger firm several years back, the National Research Center. So that's a little bit about the proposal and the firm. If you're comfortable with this, or comfortable approving that, what we would do is then just a budget amendment to cover that at a subsequent meeting. And open it up to any questions of process or anything.
On the, I just got a different price figure, Mark. The remote results, is this like a takeaway or add to this quote? Cost $2,400 just to tell us the result of this. I can read the results.
I was thinking the same thing.
Yeah,
I'll get that.
We don't have to. Yeah, I mean, and if y'all aren't comfortable with, you said most clients do because they'll spend quite a bit of time, you know, going through the results and will know some things about doing surveys and sampling and that you know, staff might not be as knowledgeable about, but. It, you know, if that's something, we get the results, we can go through it, and I can, you know, do that and follow up with questions to them that you may have that I can't answer. That's fine.
I'm really surprised about the Spanish translation fee as well, because most programs or search engines, you can click and translate your own documents. It makes me wonder if there's not, you know, compatible with what most folks would be using on their computer, where they can have that opportunity to translate themselves, or, but I definitely feel like if that's the only way to do it, then yes, we need to do that. I don't care if it's 10 or 200, you still should have it available. But.
Right.
So I'm just wondering about the whole interface of it, if it's possible to do it on your own.
No, I have to ask that.
Have to ask.
Yeah, I, you know, I was just talking about staff about that, and if you want to do it, I'm comfortable with, you know, recommending this, and it's your call on it, but we don't encounter a lot of our residents that, you know, have a difficult time communicating with service request issues or services, or have someone to translate. So I didn't quite see it as big of a need, but if you all want to include it, you know, by all means, you know, we'll include that in there.
I'd like to see it included. I want to make sure this is inclusive as possible. And I guess I'm not here talking about like an add-on, like a browser or something for the Spanish translation. I just don't want to make it any more difficult for anybody, so I'm just trying to understand.
Well, if my 11-year-old students can do it, I would think anybody could, but on
what do you mean, like copy and paste it?
No, they don't even have to do that. So when I go back to work, I'll look at it. I know it's through Google they can do that, and I know on their Chromebook they can do that. So I just need to look and see various ways that can be done to make sure that it would be something that somebody normally would pick up.
Or we could find somebody on staff that's fluent in Spanish. And I don't even know if we're going to have anybody that's going to want it, but we could use a translator. I mean, $1,300, that's a lot of money for the probably very few number of people that actually have a problem with English. I mean, there may be some that are dual speaking, but it just seems like a lot of money that may not be used at all.
I guess we'll know that for sure, though.
Yeah. And
I hate to exclude anybody that may not be an English speaker. What are you going to say, Marcus?
I was just saying, I know I mentioned we don't typically have a lot of folks that seem to have a big language barrier, you know, Spanish, that are primary Spanish speaking people. But then you may not see or hear from some who don't because of that. So if there's a,
I mean, we don't do that for our tax bills or our town notices, anything else.
Yeah, but this is also on the record, though. Not only for the town notices too, but they're also not getting that. That same communication that I guess owners are getting.
Are these questions, is this a sample of what they would do, or can we go through and pick and choose?
So basically, if you look at the Coronado, California example I gave you back, I believe it's through question. Question 12, excuse me, 10, and then when you get into 12, I believe is when they get into their specialized questions.
Like, for instance, there's one or two here that I just don't even think would be applicable for us. Like, how much do you support or oppose city pursuing lowered speed limits? I know our hands are kind of tied in those matters.
Yeah, they, in the example here, and I believe it's past question 12, they get into, and it must be a particular interest there, and not that it's not to Fletcher, but there's some things they're dealing with, stormwater management, libraries, they ask some questions. So
and there'll be several iterations before we go.
Oh, yeah, yeah, no, we'll get the base questions of the National Citizen Survey, which really will address quality of life and evaluation of services for Fletcher, and then we'll work on it. You know, once you see that, then some specialized questions or special issues that you can ask about there. And I had some suggestions from the staff before last month, and just some things, just observing of interest. Staff observations of things that to give interest to residents, but and based on, you know, feedback from y'all. So we'll get that, get the draft together, and we'll have department heads look at it as well. And that'll be done before it's sent, so you'll have that opportunity.
What about sending a robocall out to the whole town saying we're going to be sending out a town-wide survey in the near future? Do we have any residents who only speak Spanish? Ask them to respond to town halls. If we get responses, then we can make a decision.
Well, we're also have that Spanish speaker do the call, right?
Now you're going back, like I said before, we don't do it for anything else.
Yeah, but I'm saying,
I agree.
Yeah. Yeah, we should go for other things too.
I just don't think we have that many people.
Are you taking anyone else to put on questions, or do you just have staff develop what you want?
Oh, please, if you have some. Now, we'll be limited on the number of additional individual, but yeah, whatever ideas you've got that you think are key or timely issues for Fletcher, let me know. Matt put some in the last report, you know, growth, traffic, and some of those things are beyond our control because DOT does a lot of it and we have input with them, but you know, it could be residential growth, it could be greenways, you know, we're trying to work on extension of our greenways, town center project. I mean, those are kind of the, I guess, the three big ones to me, just based on what I've observed and just talking to staff about it. I was going to say, I mean, you can think about it between now and then. And I mean, you don't have to make a decision next week either if you need more time on this. But if you have other questions or you have a decent idea what you'd like to do as far as approving or going forward with this, just let me know.
I just have one more question.
Sure.
Are we? I'm hearing that maybe there's some not in agreement of the remote presentation of the results. If we don't do the presentation, how tough would it be for staff to present all the results? I just find surveying is kind of a complex thing.
Yeah, I don't know, because we haven't never presented the results of, you know, really in-depth survey like this. Some of it, I mean, to Trevor's
a sample of the result.
I get you a copy of results. I downloaded a whole bunch of stuff on that when I was looking at North Carolina communities that have used Polco and some other surveying firms. And you can see that.
It'd be interesting if we could contact one of the communities that did it and just ask them, you know, is extra money for results a big benefit, or should we just read the results ourselves?
Because it's not even, they're not even done here. It's
no.
It's
simply.
Yeah.
That's when they done the results from the point of
I thought it was high for that, too. I thought they'd at least be coming to the meeting for, I don't know if that was hold over from the height of COVID or you don't have to do that. When I saw how much I figured they'd include that within
their
and I'll contact the person who's been providing that. I've had a couple phone calls with them, teams meeting calls, or talked about process with other places and given that feedback.
Any other questions, Tom? Item 7, that's required of public hearings that's in the PSA agreement, the town center project. Do you have anything to add to that part?
So I've been keeping you informed of what's going on with the results of the traffic impact analysis. And basically, we're trying to sit back down with DOT and get to a place with these traffic mitigation measures where it's in a, I guess what, at least to the town and developer, feels a more reasonable place based on what the consultant had to do for the developer. So they have to go through some very specific guidelines based on DOT's manual that the consultant they used, Matt and Craig. I think they were just a little perplexed at what came back based on what they've seen in other similar situations. So I guess a couple things. Wednesday, we're getting together with a traffic engineer who consultants had experience going over these results with, and the district engineer, to see if we can make some headway as far as getting to, I guess, what feels more reasonable place on the mitigation recommendations. I think I've gone over them, but they came back with like several other intersections beyond what was in the initial recommendations that went to traffic management and then back to the local division. So they were including things like Wood Hill entrance, so Wood Hill and 25, down where the traffic signal is at King Creek in the library. It's already signalized. There's really not much you can do there other than adding turn lanes. And then even our intersection right here at Old King Creek and East Standing Bridge, which is basically right near the railroad tracks here. And the delay in response times to those two areas was, see as significant enough to warrant doing some type of mitigation improvements. The base recommendations on it were another exit leaving where basically where Depot Street is, so kind of midsection of the project area, another lane, no problem with that. Some reconfiguration of the signalization at Power Gap in 25, and then the third thing was adding a right turn lane as you're coming towards town hall or heading east. And that was probably the most significant. And they had, you know, some, it's not impact of this project, but that was something that's really needed already. So, but now they come back with additional things. We're trying to get to a place where what's a reasonable set on this, and they need more time. The extension, and I'll have it for you this week because our attorney and the developer's attorney go back and forth a little bit on it, but it's essentially extending it to the end of December and just putting some more language in there to just specify that the reason this is being extended is because of the resolution of the traffic mitigation efforts or recommendations. That's essentially where we're at with it right now. And I should have the draft extension a little later this week. So
I don't understand how they're tapping these developers for all this stuff, and they're not saying a word about the two big subdivisions that are going in there on St. John's Road that are going to have more impact than this.
Well, I can't speak for those because I don't think they're saying not a word, but not the level of scrutiny as far as improvements that have to be made as a result of this project. So,
and this extension will be through the end of the year, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Any other questions or comments?
I'm fine with it. Do we want to? With this consent, or do we want to discuss it again next week?
Well, there's a public hearing. I'm sorry. I Coach just spoke more about that. Our attorney, Ashley Anderson, had been working on this project, suggested that because we were adding some more language to the agreement and extending it out, so.
Is she working for Rika's office or is it?
No, she's on her own now. She's with Sanford Holzhauser, which does a lot of the financing work on council, they call it. And then they have attorneys that currently work on development-related projects.
Okay, moving on to item number 8, the use of ARPA funds for less restrictive administrative requirements. Do we have a committee?
Thank you, Mayor. So I know we've been talking a lot about potential projects, and I've got an update about the sewer letter that went out. But so the school of government's been providing advice all along since the ARP funds came out. And one of the determinations that they made is with the communities that have received an allocation and done this, and it's at the $10 million or less, they can do a revenue replacement option and using the funds, which is essentially, I know it's supplanting revenue that we're already receiving here, but basically the whole gist of this revenue replacement is they found a way you could use the funds towards salary and benefits, you know, within our operating budget. That's where the ARP allocation gets used, and then it obviously frees up those funds that you'd be using in salary and benefits for other things, you know, anything that's a legal public purpose of local government, which essentially ARP funds was doing once they had opened up authority to do those types of things. The big benefit of doing this is that we don't have to follow a lot of the federal requirements for then other things you want to do with those revenues that are freed up. You do with the ARP allocation. If we get into capital projects, which is essentially what's been discussed with you, then you get into all the federal guidelines, data spanking, wage requirements, all kinds of things that add a lot of expense and complexity to it. For example, like when we did the, the project turned out well, and I, at least from my perspective, I'm glad we did it, but the our whole corridor improvement project, so everything that was done along there, that was essentially federal money that went to the state and then down to us. So it has a lot of layers of cost and complexity to it. So this essentially, if you approve us working on this and doing that, would free up those funds. What I would recommend then, if you go this route, is at the end of the fiscal, or at the end of the period where you use the ARP funds towards salary and benefits, it uses the 2.6 million, that you do a fund balance designation with the, you should have fund balance in that amount, that you do a fund balance designation for capital projects to be determined, that same process that we were trying to identify projects for the ARP. So that's, a lot of communities are doing this. This isn't just a Fletcher thing. It's a ease of use of the funds.
Any kind of restarts your, or eliminates that deadline of having to allocate that money.
Thank you, that's another good point. We're under a timeline. All the funds have to be committed by the end of 2024. And they have to be all expended by the end of 2026. So yes, it stops that clock. But I would recommend if you do this route, we have to set up some federal, it's not very complicated. There's some federal compliance policy things we have to set up to do that. But once we do that, we can spend the money towards salary benefits, and then it frees that up. And then at the end of the fiscal year, and it may have to go into the next fiscal year, depending on how that cutoff falls with the
fully spending the funds, then you can do a fund balance restriction for, I would say, capital projects, and what would be determined would be a wise use of the monies, or one potential good use of it.
Well, I think what you're suggesting makes a lot of sense. Yeah, it makes sense. It rules a lot of restrictions. It sounds like a problem would be a less administrative burden for staff, if I'm hearing that correctly.
I just want to see 100% of that money go to improvements and stuff in the town. I don't want to see any of that money go to regular operation expenses.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Well, I think it makes sense.
If you're okay with that, well, I guess for the next week we'd ask for some motion to start that process. We'll have to do, there'll probably be some other council action requirements. Yeah, well, you'll have to appropriate the money towards that. So this would just at least allow us to start working on the policy implementation requirements to do that. And then Heather has set up a special project ordinance to do that, and we go from there, or modify it from what we have in place.
I'm really surprised the federal government is allowing that. I mean, to me, we're not going to have an issue, but some towns could use it to pay their bills.
Well, you know, some are in poor financial condition, and, you know, it helps with their fund balance. Our fund balance is healthy, so, but, yeah.
Well, I would recommend at that meeting in Asheville, if they said, pick out projects you already got, so you'll lose the money, and like that, there's money you can allocate the money after that for something else. And
yes.
Just point of staff.
Yep. Yeah, and to just reiterate Bob's comment, that you would have something for the record that says you want to, once you get to the end of expenditure of funds, at the end of that fiscal year, you do some type of the designation of those of that equivalent amount of money. And then we still have to follow all our procurement methods by state law, but it just gives you a lot more flexibility, and it'll make the dollars go farther too, because it'll be less expensive.
Sounds good to me. Any other questions, comments, concerns about that?
So how are we going to discuss that money? Do you just going to have that as a...
If you can do it as a motion to authorize us to start the process, and then we'll have to come back with no additional council action to designate the funds towards salary benefits. So, but at least it lets us know we can start working on that officially.
Appreciate you looking into that. And our final item, are your comments, Mr. Manning?
Thank you. Just two things real quick. So the letter that went out to the residents on Westfeld, North Hudson Lane, and Dogwood Terrace on a potential sewer project. Christine got that in the mail. She's been keeping track of the response. And you've got a copy of the spreadsheet that you've been maintaining in front of you, and basically you can see, I believe there's been 11 responses so far, and they've been phoning in. We've had a couple people that have come in to the office, or one or two.
Two came in, the rest have phoned in.
So you can see the notes on here, and I guess out of the six out of the five were yes, or six out of the 11, excuse me, and five were no. The deadline to receive, or we've asked residents to provide a response, would be October the 14th. If we don't, I mean, we're not going to hear back from everybody by then. What we could do is, especially if there's a lot of people that haven't responded yet, we could try and find good phone numbers or people who know the person who lives there and kind of to reach out and give them an opportunity to respond if they're interested in doing this or not. Because I think it'd be real important to get that And also keep in mind, you know, when we did the mailing, it wound up grabbing the four, there's four lots that I put the map, that color map that MSD had done, and there's four lots that are already have sewer available to them, and they're one of the people who contact, residents contact us, that they're on sewer. But there's four that are on, it's Dogwood Terrace there, that have sewer available to them. So if you back those out of the 38, you're at 34. So if you want to get at least 50% positive response, we need at least 17 of those to be a yes, if that's, you know, the criteria threshold that you want to use. But we just want, I just want to give you an update on it. Christine's been doing a good job of keeping this organized here and keeping track of it, and it's had some good conversations. Is there anything else you want to add?
No, it's okay. Been fine. Everybody's been, you know, a lot of people have questions and they're curious, and if they commit to it, you know, do they have to do it now? You know, and one lady said she would be interested, but I noted there she just spent $4,000 on a drain field in her backyard. She said so.
And then that kind of money. It seems like the majority is all this except for two on Hudson, and one of those two isn't even a response from the owners.
No, it's not, and that's why I made that note there, because he's not even in that house. He's in this senior facility, and that guy's trying to buy the house, and he said he'd know the end of this month if he could buy it. Because if he did buy it, he was interested in that house as well as his own.
So it makes you really feel like Westfield is really the main issue.
Also, that whole question, that person of like Christine says, it's the same person.
I wonder how that that one woman, Diana Lane Miller, how she got service over on Dogwood. Well, she must be before the deal or something and flown the other way.
Yeah, because according to her map.
She's one of these two houses right here. I know the one.
Yeah. Maybe there's a little bit of margin of error there on that map. Well, you know, October 14th is technically the deadline that we set. And Christina will continue to keep track of that. And then, like I said, we can try and reach out by some other ways to hopefully elicit a response from those who haven't responded yet. If there's any questions or anything else, I'll move on.
And when you talked to them, they said that their plans were to run all these lines down the road, right?
Yes.
These drawings just kind of don't make sense to me. Where they've got some of these lines running, there's already sewer.
Yeah, I mean, my understanding is that if this goes to design, it'll be in the road. Now, again, you got to come across. There's going to be 2 to 3 properties that they're going to have to get sewer easements coming from Glen Springs and South Chase come over to attach to Westville Road.
So are this one just dig a big ditch down the road, or do they tunnel use the devices?
Yes, they bore
the holes.
They bore the hole.
So minimal damage.
We'll go through parts of someone's rock. You know, it's the only way they'll be able to get that to come all the way over. Or yards, I think they estimated
two pretty good lines. They may have to dig
close
up. Yeah. Or they trench it, I don't know, boring or trenching. Yeah. And basically, the sewer's going to have to go underground, obviously, but through some yards. And, you know, you've got to get the easement from those folks. So either negotiate it, or your only other option, and I mean, you all have the authority to do it, but I don't want to do that, it would be condemned again. So if you have a holdout and it's not a dollar amount or comfortable paying. I just have one other another thing, unless there's other questions on that. There's a possible grant funding opportunity. So Eric Rufo was contacted today by Tristan Winkler, who's the director of the French Broad River MPO, so the regional transportation group for our area. And there is, under the federal infrastructure bill, there's a grant program that's come out of that called Reconnecting Communities. You can use that funding for greenway construction or extension. So he had contacted Eric because he knows we've been trying to work with Conserving Carolina to get our Cane Creek Greenway, or become the Meritor Greenway, once over there. I think on our master plan it says Meritor, to get that completed out that way. And so I think they're working with the city of Hendersonville right now on an application. I don't have the dollar amount that's available. Right now, it's a 50-50 match. That might change to an 80-20, but even 50-50 would be a great funding source. And, you know, let's say you free up some funds because of the use of the ARP for something else, then that frees up some money if you want to appropriate it for the greenway construction. So, anyways, that's if Eric's reaching back out to Rebecca Robinson and others from Conserving Carolina to kind of see where they're at with that, because they're supposed to be working on this. The biggest issue they've been doing has been the section that would go across the Fernleaf property, and they were getting an issue resolved there, so they got some grant funding to basically get the easement across there.
I think we should pursue it.
I agree.
Make sure we don't let it slip through our fingers.
Yeah,
I agree. Do not action.
It's federal funds, so that would be some of the hassle. But it could be a really good source to get this project moving along.
I mean, someday there will be a great greenway that runs all the way from Nashville to Hendersonville. And we need to do everything we can to be ready to tap into that when it gets there.
I agree.
Anyways, just wanted to make you aware of that, and as we get more details, and if an application comes together, we'll do that, get that together. And that's all I have.
Any other business for council? We'll go into closed session next week for personnel matters. There's no one to get into our motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So motion to adjourn, you have a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the charge, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? We are adjourned.